Here we're going to talk about solving equations by factoring, and we're going to start with an observation. So let's observe that if you take a and you multiply it by b and you get 0, well, what is that telling you? Well, you're multiplying two things together and you're getting 0. Well, what has to be true about either a or b? Well, you'd say at least one of them has got to be 0, right? So we say that this is logically equivalent to a being 0 or b being 0. Okay, that is, if you know a times b is 0, then you can draw the conclusion that either a is 0 or b is 0 or both. And it goes the other way as well. If either a equals 0 or b equals 0, then you know that a times b is 0. Okay, so why do we care about that? That's going to help us solve equations when things get a little more complicated. So far when we've been, you know, solving equations, we've been handling things like this. Like solve, you know, 3x plus 5 is equal to 7, okay? And what's our strategy been? Well, it's been to isolate x. That is, get x on the left-hand side, right? And you'd subtract 5 from both sides and then divide by both sides by 3. Now, we're going to be solving equations where it's not x raised to the first power like it is here, but we're going to be solving equations that maybe look like this, like 4x squared plus 5x is equal to 6. So the difference is that here you have x raised to the second power, and likewise you could have something like this, you know, 7x cubed plus 4x squared plus 2x plus 5 is equal to 0. Okay, so this is clearly more complicated because now here you have x raised to the third power, right? So when you have these types of equations, we're no longer going to be using the strategy of isolating x. What we're going to be doing instead is we are going to be starting off by making the right-hand side equal to 0, okay? So we're going to start by making the right-hand side, right-hand side of the equation equal to 0, okay? And then once we do that, we'll be in this situation where we have 0 on the right-hand side, and then we'll factor the left-hand side. So that's going to be our strategy. We're going to get 0 on the right-hand side, and then we're going to factor the left-hand side so that we can draw these conclusions, okay? Now remember, this strategy holds when the exponent is a 2 or a 3 or anything higher than simply an exponent of 1. So when you're taking, you know, a quiz or a test, you have to differentiate between these two situations, right? If it's raised to the first power, you simply isolate x. If it's a polynomial higher than, you know, where the exponent here is a higher than a 1, where it's no longer just linear, where it's squared or cubed, then we're going to use this strategy. Okay, let's see how this goes. Let's solve 4x squared equals 9x. So the very first thing I notice is that x is being raised to the second power, right? So that tells me, oh, let's employ our strategy of getting 0 on the right-hand side. So I'm going to subtract 9x from both sides. And what do I have? Well, the left-hand side is going to be 4x squared minus 9x. I can't combine these, right, because they're not like terms. So I just write them horizontally like that. And the right-hand side is 0. Okay, now, we said earlier that we want to get a times b is equal to 0, right? We want the left-hand side to be factored. And this is not factored, right? We still have subtraction right here. We want multiplication. So can we factor this? Sure, right? We start with a GCF. They have an x in common. So it's going to be x times 4x minus 9 is equal to 0. And then once you have a times b is 0, right, a times b equals 0, what you then do is you set a to 0. That's the first thing. And then you set b to 0. Well, that means I set a, which is this, right? I set x to 0. And then I set b, which is all of that. So 4x minus 9 is equal to 0. This one's already done, right? X is just equal to 0. But over here, now notice how it's x to the first power? You solve this equation by isolating the x. So 4x, you add 9 to both sides. 4x equals 9. And now divide both sides by 4. So we get x is equal to 9 over 4. And so those are my two answers, right? X equals 0 and x equals 9 over 4. Okay, so remember our strategy. Get 0 on the right-hand side. Whenever you see something squared or cubed or higher than just simply x to the first power. Okay, let's try another one like that. Let's solve x times 2x minus 3 equals 14. Now, this one's a little tricky. Do you see how it's multiplication to begin with? You might say to yourself, well, it's only x raised to the first. But in order to assess what strategy we want to use, you first have to multiply this out. So we're first going to take that x and distribute it. So it's going to be x times 2x, and then x times negative 3. So it's going to be 2x squared, and then minus 3x, right? X times negative 3 equals 14. And now I see, oh, it's really the second case, right? It's x raised to the second power, so I want to get 0 on the right-hand side. And so you first multiply things out so you can assess which strategy to use. So our strategy is, let's get 0 on the right-hand side. So I'm going to subtract 14 from both sides. So now it's going to be, let's see, 2x squared minus 3x minus 14 is equal to 0. And now we want to factor that left-hand side. But to factor this trinomial, I'm going to use the AC method. So I'm going to multiply A, which is 2, by C, which is negative 14. And when I multiply those together, I get negative 28. Now, the way the AC method works is you want to think of numbers that multiply to be negative 28, but add to be negative 3. And you always want to do this systematically. So I start off with negative 1 times 28. Now, I know it's pretty obvious to me that these don't add together to be negative 3, but the whole point is that if you do it systematically, you're likely to save time. So the next one's going to be, let's see, negative 2 times positive 14. That's not the winning combination, right? 3 doesn't go into 28, but negative 4, well, 4 does, right? So it's going to be negative 4 times positive 7. That's almost it. These add to be positive 3, but we want negative 3. So it's going to be negative 7 and positive 4. So just take a moment and look how I've organized this table. I have all the negatives on the left and the positives on the right, and I'm increasing the numbers on the left, right? 1, 2, 4, 7. I'm going systematically through my factorizations. Okay, then what do you do? Well, this combination of numbers here, you take them and you write the negative 3 as negative 7 plus 4. So it's going to be 2x squared minus 7x plus 4x minus 14 is equal to 0. That's the whole point of finding negative 7 and positive 4, right? You use those numbers to split up the negative 3, like that. Okay, now what do these have in common? You want to factor by grouping, right? So the first two have an x in common, so it's x times 2x minus 7. And the next two have a 2 in common, so it's 2 times 2x minus 7. And don't forget the addition sign right in the middle. So if you drop the addition sign, you will accidentally have factored it, but that we still have a sum at this stage. And now I say to myself, what do these have in common? Well, clearly a 2x minus 7. So we've got 2x minus 7, right? These both have a 2x minus 7, so it gets factored out. And what am I left with? Well, here I'm left with an x, and for the next one I'm left with a positive 2, and that's equal to 0. So now what you do, it's, you know, a times b equals 0. So you set these individually equal to 0. So you get 2x minus 7 equals 0, and then we get the second one's going to be x plus 2 equals 0. So I add 7 to both sides. So I get 2x equals 7. X is equal to 7 halves. That's my first solution. For the second solution, I subtract 2 from both sides. And I get x is equal to negative 2. And these would be my two solutions. Positive 7 halves and negative 2. Okay, so that is the beginning of how we solve equations by factoring. And we'll do some more of more examples like this in another video, examples that are a little more complicated. Okay, until then.